Is this one is on still? Yes, okay, thanks. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to give a short presentation about observations and lessons learned of a number of ongoing monitoring initiatives that were collected in the Netherlands during a study. The fact sheet was made together with a number of colleagues of mine from TNO, also in collaboration with Mr. Drieman of Fugro Geoservices. The study of which I present the conclusions now was performed by the SBR Keurnet from the Netherlands. It's a Dutch association with partners from building industry that initiates research topics, stimulates innovations, develops guidelines, and disseminates knowledge. And one of the studies performed by SBR Keurnet was done by Committee 1992. And the question to be answered was, how can monitoring be applied and promoted in construction and maintenance? The committee consisted out of numerous parties from TNO, but also Delft University, governmental parties, municipalities, and building and consulting industry. So the idea was to take a number of ongoing monitoring projects and have a closer look at them, answering questions like, are they successful or not? Are there opportunities? Are there threats? And if so, why? And can we then extract lessons from that? Now, how did we evaluate these monitoring projects? We decided to do that based on a scheme for monitoring. I guess this is one of the many schemes that you can think of in case of monitoring, and probably this one also has some flaws, but it turned out to be very useful in structuring our study about the monitoring systems. I'd like to point to the top of the scheme, where we see on the left a demand, an objective, a goal that is searched for, which has to be or should be balanced with the parties on the right-hand side, giving the supply of information and of monitoring systems. The flowchart that you see on the screen has a number of blocks, and they are also labeled with A, B, C, and so on. And these labelings will be used later on in presenting the state of the number of ongoing monitoring systems. Normally, one should start on the left-hand side of the scheme in defining the objective. So one might think of maintenance optimizations, service life extensions, gaining insight, for instance, in specific mechanisms, and owners or stakeholders are then interested in how these goals and objectives can be optimized and managed based on proper decisions and measures to be taken. For instance, optimized maintenance policies or operational measures, strengthening renewal, but also, as was also introduced this morning and this afternoon, gathering information for learning. So, designed by experiments or introducing innovative projects or products. Going to the right, in once these objectives are looked for, you also look for enabling and supporting models that describe the problems at hand. And normally these models then also give incentives in proper quantities that can be measured if needed. Examples of these models or quantities are models for traffic loads or chloride ingress or crack growth. And if these give a need for extra information, you can go on to the definition of the requirements of the monitoring. So that would be a stage of phase C in our scheme. Going further towards the design and build of the monitoring system, the operational phase with respect to acquisition, and we are almost there, but then of course it's also a matter of getting the information out of the data and giving the data and information towards the model to optimize then the decision under phase stage G. Apart from the scheme just presented, we also looked at some additional aspects that are important in classifying the state of monitoring systems. And they are listed in this sheet. On top, there is the interests and needs of the owner or the user of the objectives. That's also including the higher level societal and economic needs and interests. Then, of course, the opportunities and threats. What efficiencies and successes are found, but also what kind of factors are found that are hindering a large-scale application of structural health monitoring. The time horizon, is it temporarily or indefinitely in time? A cost benefit, qualitative, but also, of course, quantitative. With respect to, for instance, single cost or initial cost, but also what would it be if one starts upscaling the systems. Data management is also found to be very important. For instance, is the organization ready to deal with these large, in general, large amounts of data and is able to manage it and couple it to existing information? And last but not least, but also the technology readiness level, the TRL level of the systems, to what extent the system is ready for repeated and also organization-wide application. So far for the scheme that we applied, so it's about time to show some results. It's probably readable. In this matrix, we see five projects that were all dealing with maintenance optimization as an objective. So some examples, for instance, sensor system, monitoring system to measure the light intensity of a tunnel in Rotterdam with the goal to optimize the cleaning frequency. This system came up to phase or stage C, so it is not operational, not found to be operational yet. It's probably due to the fact that it has to be incorporated into the organization. There are two examples of joints in highway viaducts. Again, with the goal to optimize maintenance frequencies. Also these, now one of these two is still found to be in a proof of principle and proof of concept stage. And the second one is indeed already running and is successfully applied. And there's a classical one, chloride penetration in concrete. We are in a feasibility study with respect to this. So phase D. Some pictures. Here's the picture of the mass tunnel in Rotterdam with the light system or lighting system we are talking about. This one I didn't mention, I'm sorry about that, but this is about tags or radio frequency IDs that enable the identification of structures, but also components within structures, and thus also decrease uncertainties that can take place, for instance, during inspections. So it's more with respect to data management and a little bit out of context with monitoring, maybe. A second set of results is presented by this matrix. We are now looking at a different objective. In this case, we're looking at service life extension. Examples shown here involve, for instance, on top the moving abutments of a bridge, where there was a need of in gaining the insight in the mechanisms taking place. There's again a bridge joint where we, or they, the people working on it, successfully applied the monitoring system and as such could delay the maintenance by and also then successfully have the replacement be combined with other maintenance actions going on the road. There's a steel deck of the Van Brienenoord bridge in Rotterdam where the crack growth is monitored. For those of you interested, there was a paper also included in the booklet of the first workshop in Copenhagen about this. And then again, one for concrete, the alkali silica reaction deterioration, also in a highway. And most of these projects presented in this matrix are running up and running successfully, except for the first one, where we did not yet, or they did not yet, found conclusive answers about the mechanisms looked for. So this is a picture of the example with respect to the moving abutments. And this is the example of the crack growth modeling and monitoring in the Van Brienenoord bridge in Rotterdam. A third set of projects that we looked at is presented in this last matrix. It's about getting insight in behavior of systems and structures. First one is an interesting one, where we are now introducing synthetic or fiber-reinforced plastic lock gates in hydraulic structures in the Netherlands. And one of the questions that is to be answered is how can temperature load modeling be properly designed and applied from the regulations point of view. Also, let's say, a kind of innovative path that is walked is with respect to high-strength concrete. High-strength concrete applied at the Styx bridge in Blaricum. Gain insight in the creep and shrinkage behavior. There are the orthotropic steel elements in the Gellekoppen bridge in Utrecht, where we want to determine the additional load bearing capacity. And there's a way in motion system for the at several places in the highways in the Netherlands with the goal to evaluate the actual traffic loads, whether or not they are still in compliance with the Eurocode. All of these are basically all successfully up and running in the Netherlands. A picture of a way motion system, and also a picture of temperature data that is gathered for the synthetic lock gates in Werkendam. So some conclusions about this study. First of all, the scheme or the flow chart, it turned out to be a very useful guidance for appraisal. It facilitated the monitoring system design, balancing demand and supply. It also facilitates the comparison of different monitoring systems, getting feedback, communication with respect to monitoring systems. The monitoring systems themselves, well, most of them turned out to be composed of out-of-the-shell components. They are, in general, there are a lot of pilots in it by pioneers, so mostly research-driven. Some of them are also business-driven. Not yet always labeled as successful. And what a big lesson learned is that if there are monitoring projects with clear objectives and a good interaction with supply, they in general turn out to be more successful. With respect to the application and upscale, and I think this was also mentioned today, that sometimes, or maybe too often, we feel or find a resistance from practice. A number of causes could be mentioned. Sometimes it's argued that problems are not urgent enough. So in terms of let us proceed the way we always did, it's good. Sometimes the problems are too urgent, so then they don't want to take any risk. Better safe than sorry. Why start monitoring if we just can replace the element? And finally, the last two, they are with respect to the costs and benefits. It's about who's going to pay and who's going to benefit. That's also an important issue that plays a part in application and upscaling. And that's not only with respect to who and whom, but also with respect to time. Often you have to invest a lot of money now and be rewarded much later. And maybe you're not the one who gets the reward. So these conclusions, I think they put some pressure on cost action, where we're all involved, and probably the way that we all together are working on it should indeed enable better the applications of monitoring systems, as we are all working on a more structured approach, putting the objectives in front, with a good balance on demand and supply. And last but not least, also with respect to the costs, I think euros are always a good argument to get things done. So the quantification of the value of information is very important for getting monitoring systems applied. Thank you very much. That was my presentation.
Okay, thank you very much for sharing this experience from the Netherlands. So as for the first part, we'll have a short discussion. I would like to steal 5 minutes of your time of the coffee break. And I would like to invite the three speakers here to join me on the stage. So in the second part, we've even widened the scope of structures and